rookie series of tutorials is for new users of iMovie 10.2. It'll quickly get you started and help you understand how to easily create videos on your Mac. The videos use my years of editing experience to cover just the items you need to know, without going into unnecessary details that will bog you down. This fourth lesson will look at the toolbar in detail. The toolbar is above the viewer window, and depending on what type of clip you've got selected in the timeline, different icons will be white. Let's look at color first. The left-hand icon shows the color choices. The first selection is auto. This adjusts the image as iMovie thinks best. Select a clip in the timeline. This has got too much blue in it, so selecting auto will warm up this image. Match color will match the color of one clip with the color in another clip. That's probably a better one that you want to work with, and so both clips will now look the same. Select the clip you want to change first. Then click match color, and the viewer shows the two images. The one on the right is the one you're going to change. As you hover over other clips, and that's even in the browser, the cursor changes to an eyedropper. And wherever you click that, the color cast will change the color in the effect of the right-hand clip in the viewer. You can turn the effect on and off to see the changes, and you can delete the change or apply the change. Simply click to apply and the X to clear. White balance will correct images that didn't have the white balance correctly set in the camera. It'll adjust the color tone to a more natural color. So select the Opera House still photo. This works with both video and stills. I've selected a still here and I've clicked the white balance button. You'll again see an eyedropper, and this time you'll click on a white point in the viewer only. You can click on different whites and greys to change to a pleasant tone. And a tip, avoid white points that are reflections or a bright white point, like a bright reflection of the sun on Windows. Skin tone warms an image to warm skin tones that are not natural. I'll use this image of hands to show you what I mean. And another eyedropper. Tip, one thing to be aware of with color correction is that a small change is all that's required to improve an image. I have a saying that a little bit can be too much. Further color correction can be achieved with the next button, that's the painter's palette. The set of dots work as follows. The far left dot changes the blacks in the image, and the far right dot the whites, that's the bright points. When red shows in the line, then you've gone too far beyond acceptable boundaries. The dot with the white and the black is the contrast. The other two change the tones between the brightest and the blacks. And a tip, if you hover over a dot and wait for a second, you'll see the tooltips that explain what each dot does. The center slider adjusts the amount of color. Right increases and left removes, so you go to black and white. And the far right slider adds yellow to the right or blue to the left, so that's warm to the right or cool to the left. The reset brings changes back to the original camera's color settings. Reset all resets all changes to that clip. The next button is the crop button. It again works with both stills and video. Fit shows the image at full size. If the aspect ratio is different than the project, you may see black bars. Fit to fill fills the black bars into the aspect of the project. And Ken Burns gives a video effect to still images. It also works with video. The settings are, you set the image at start to start a movement and N to finish a movement. I'll set the Opera House image with a starting position with mainly sky showing and end with a full view of the sails. I'll now play that. The beginning and the end point can be swapped with this button. And tip, Ken Burns plays for the full length of the clip, you can't change that. But for a workaround, click the eye above for secrets of the Ken Burns effect. All of the tools we've used so far work with both video and stills in the main timeline. There's a tool set that works with connected videos and stills that are connected above the timeline. This overlay tool set has four subheadings and only shows when a connected clip is selected. The first is cutaway. You can change opacity to see the clip below show through. You can change fade in and fade out of that opacity effect. And if you look at the clip in the timeline, you can adjust those fades. Both the beginning and the end fades are fixed though, and they adjust together. The second selection is blue-green screen. This removes blues and greens in a connected image, allowing you to see through to the clip below. Think of your news channel showing the weather, with a presenter in front of the weather map. The softness slider will help you adjust the edges. And a tip, good green screen effects require an original green screen image with the correct lighting effects applied. The next subset is the split screen, and you can adjust this to be left, right, top or bottom. And a tip, you can use this in conjunction with the crop tool to show a zoom into the image. The fourth subset is picture in picture. You can resize and reposition the image. You can also animate these changes. Click the eye above for a video on that. Next is stabilization of the shaky video. As with my comments about noise removal, stabilization is not a magic bullet, but it does help some of the shaking in the video. It'll not fix jumps in the video where the camera moves significantly, say as shots from a car, or in this case on the water. So how do you use it? Select the clip and check to stabilize. You'll see a note, analyzing for dominant motion. This will take a little bit of time, and you can adjust the amount. Where there's a camera jump, you may see fuzzy frames as the stabilization joins those frames. And always with stabilization, the image will be zoomed in a little, which can make the video look a little bit soft, depending on the resolution of your original footage and the amount of stabilization that you've dialed in. Rolling shutter can also help with that side-to-side camera movement. And next are the speed controls. This allows you to do slow-mo and speed up clips. Select a clip in the timeline and click the dial icon. You can select several preset speeds or adjust your own. Now check the clip in the timeline. At the right edge is a small speed dot. The cursor changes to a speed dial. Drag to the right to slow down the clip and to the left to speed it up. And you'll see either the tortoise or the hare. And you've also got an option to reverse the clip here. The next button lets you add effects to a clip. Select the clip filter button to add video effects and the audio effect button to add audio effects. As you hover over the video, select the thumbnails and you'll see a preview in the viewer. Hover over the audio thumbnails for an audio preview. The audio tools in the toolbar were covered in detail in Lesson 3, so I won't add them here. Then finally in Lesson 2, I mentioned what happens when you drag a clip from the browser inside a clip in the timeline. I got you to cancel in that case, which stopped any action. And that's what you'd do if you accidentally dragged inside a clip in the timeline. But what are the other choices? and they produce quite different outcomes. Replace. We'll replace the current clip in the timeline with the length of the portion of the clip selected in the browser. So if you had a full clip, that's with the yellow outline around the whole clip, then all of that would be added to the timeline and replace the clip that's already there. Replace from start. We'll replace the clip in the timeline with the clip being dragged from the browser, but only to the length of the clip that was already in the timeline. If there's not enough footage available in the browser, you'll get a warning. The replacement will start from the first frame of the clip in the browser to as many frames as needed to fill the length of the clip that was in the timeline. Replace from end does the same, but uses the last frame of the browser clip and works backward until the required length is achieved. Insert simply inserts a selection at the point where the playhead is positioned in the timeline. Well done for getting this far. You're now an experienced iMovie editor. Go for it. Well done. I'm here to help, so if you need assistance on a specific iMovie topic, I offer free iMovie support via email, and that's for urgent issues that you're confronted with. Click the I above for a link to my free support site. Otherwise, let me know in the comments below about iMovie topics that you struggle with, and I'd be happy to produce a YouTube video to help you solve those issues. I'm also available for one-on-one internet training. Thanks for watching, and if you haven't done so already, please like, subscribe, and press the bell.